Pastor Tom here. I just want to welcome you to our last series on the Lenten series presentation. Glad that you're able to attend via online. I hope this has worked out well for you, and I hope you have learned and grown some degree in all of this. I know we do lack the conversational piece like we normally would have. And I just, be patient. We'll get back to that sometime, hopefully in the very near future. So I just wanted to take a moment and welcome you. Let's join together. If you feel like singing at home, feel free to sing at home.
Call me out upon the word.
All right, let's take a moment and bow our heads in prayer. Oh, gracious, all-knowing and loving God, Lord, we thank you for the season of Lent. Even though it has been unique, we are very thankful that we've had this opportunity to participate Wednesday evenings in this way, in this form. Lord, as we move toward Monday, Thursday, a Good Friday, and Easter, let our hearts and our minds be focused in on Jesus and the significance of Monday, Thursday, of the hand washing, of the Last Supper. Let us stay focused on remembering the significance of that that horrible cross, and never let us forget the meaning and the significance of Jesus and that empty tomb. Lord, be with us as we have our last session on the Lenten series. May this time be a time of learning and growth. And Lord, I'd pray that our minds and our hearts can be focused in on this session, and that we can let all those things that are going on in life just kind of sit up on the shelf for the short time. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so I'm not going to play like this is all perfect, okay? We're trying to make this like some kind of movie set or something. But the reality is I forgot to do the scripture, and it's supposed to be one flow from opening prayer to scripture, and I stopped at the opening prayer. So let's have the scripture. Luke 24, 50 through 53. When he had led them out of the vicinity of Bethany, he lifted up his hands and blessed them. While he was blessing them, he left them and was taken up into heaven. Then they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and they stayed continually at the temple, praising God. All right, now let's move on to our video.
You know, the new atheists like Richard Dawkins and Sam Harris and the late Chris Hitchens made a lot of noise in our society. But despite all their noise, real atheism is still pretty rare. I mean, those who would say that God absolutely does not exist are pretty hard to find. Now, if you throw in those who are agnostics, in other words, they say, well, I'm not sure if God exists, and maybe no one else is either, the number goes up a little bit, but it's still pretty low. But something that's much more prevalent in our society is not atheism. It's what Craig Gay in his book, The Way of the Modern World, calls practical atheism. You see, most people in the West believe in God. They're not atheists. But they're practical atheists. They live as if God is largely irrelevant to the everyday business of life and living. God is kept in a private place. He's my personal friend to make me feel better, to help me behave better, to kind of give me therapeutic help when I need it. But it doesn't have anything to do with the rest of the world. Now, another word for this way of thinking would be secularism. Now, again, when we hear the word secularist, many Christians think about the militant secularists, you know, like the Freedom From Religion Foundation, groups like that, who can't wait for another Christian public school student to wear a Christian t-shirt or pray at a graduation or, you know, a holiday nativity scene that they can bully right out of the public square. More insidious than the militant secularism, however, is the embedded secularism. Not really the beliefs of secularism, but the secularist mood that pervades Western society, where God is a personal, private belief to be kept to ourselves. But the world outside of that is largely of our own making. Our happiness is largely a matter of our own buying. Our problems are solved mainly through our own politicking. And even our churches are built through our own marketing. In other words, it's living life with very little reference to the presence of God in everyday life. Now, in addition to the characteristics of secularism, that, you know, we're in control of the world and that religion should be this privatized personal experience, there's a third one that author Craig Gay mentions in his book, and that's the characteristic of anxiety. Essentially, if the world is one of our own making, then it rests entirely and squarely on our own shoulders, and it's a lot heavier than we ever imagined. Now, Christians aren't immune to this sort of thinking either. In fact, as one of my friends once said, a lot of Christians are secularists with a twist. We see this world and this life in a purely secular way, but we have that promise of heaven, you know, kind of set off into the future. And that reveals the source of the Christian form of secularism that plagues the church. It comes from a deep-seated dualism in which we see this world as being something entirely separate and different than the kingdom of God that Christ came to inaugurate. Now, Scripture is quite clear on how we ought to think about this. For the Apostle John, Christ's work begins when he creates the heavens and the earth, and it runs straight through continuously until he recreates the new heavens and the new earth. Paul describes Christ as the one who's above all things, and in him all things on heaven and earth hold together, he says in Colossians. He talks about Jesus being the second Adam. The first Adam was given the task by God to rule over the created order and failed. The second Adam rules over the created order and does not fail. Philippians 2, because of his obedience to God, he's given the name which is above every name, and at that name every knee bows and every tongue confesses. The lordship of Christ is secure. But the key scene, I think, in the Scriptures that brings this to light is the ascension, and that's described by Luke in the Acts of the Apostles. Now, right before Christ ascended, the disciples are walking with him, and they ask him, at this time, are you going to restore the kingdom to Israel? And what happens next? He gets taken up to heaven. And the next chapter, Peter realizes that this is a fulfillment of the promise in the Psalms, where Jesus is seated at the right hand, and all of his enemies are put under his feet. He now rules everything. The kingdom of Israel is as big as the kingdom of the entire world. The kingdom of God is not of this earth, and it's not from this earth, but it is for this earth, because it was initiated by the one who created this world and is redeeming this world through his good work, through his life, his death, and his resurrection. Do you remember how Jesus taught us to pray? Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. The kingdom of God invades this place for the here and now. And I really like how theologian Tom Wright describes how this ought to change how we live. He really describes the task of the church as going into every corner of society, every corner where we have this illusion of control, and we have this illusion that God doesn't apply here, and we start asking the serious question, what would it look like if God were running this place? What would it look like if God were setting the rules here? And that gives us a lens to be redemptive agents for Christ in this world. For Reengage, I'm John Stone Street.
Okay, hope you enjoyed the last video presentation. I know I've mentioned this several times. He does speak a little fast. And if I could have a critique, I'd ask him to slow it down, because he does share a lot of information. And, you know, there's several of the videos that I watched multiple times just to catch everything he was saying. Even when I was working on the questions, every time it seemed like I'd have to stop and pause and think about what he was saying. So, but the beauty of all of this, it is on video, and so you can always watch it again. You can watch it multiple times so that you get the most out of it as you can. So here are the questions I have for you. The first one to start us off easy is a simple one. Do you know any real atheists, people who truly don't believe in God? The second question is, if you do know somebody like that, how do you interact with them? And in your interactions with them, do they portray that they're an atheist? In their conversations, do they make light of it like it's something significant as to defining who they are? Or can you just have a normal everyday conversation with them? Okay, the second set of questions. What does the presenter mean when he talks about secularism? Because he talks about several aspects of secularism. The second part of that question is, do we see this around us? Do we see this in us? Do we actually experience some of what he's talking about as defining secularism in our own lives? The third set of questions. Well, I'm going to say it specifically for you, because you have to contemplate this for yourself, okay? Do you see your life of faith and your life outside of faith as being dualistic? Remember what the presenter talked about, dualism. You may want to go back and watch the video again. So if you do see your part of your life as being your life and part of your life being your faith, kind of that dualistic approach, do you struggle with this? And the third part of that question is, what are you doing to work on this in your life? What are you doing to maybe overcome it? The next set of questions is, the presenter references the Lord's Prayer, the part where he says, "Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." So the question is, what might that look like? And what role do we play in that? Next question, the famous question of control. Do we have delusions? He uses the word delusions. Do we have delusions of control? And I think based on past conversations, for those who have participated and got God in the past, I think I may know the answer to that. But for those of you who have not been a part of God, you may not be aware of those conversations, so I'm going to take a guess and say you're going to be like everybody else and say, yes, we do have delusions of control. But I want you to think about it, though, and what aspects of life and where do we think we have delusions of control? And finally, ask yourselves the question, if God is running the show, what might that look like? Use your imagination to guide you based on maybe even the previous question. Actually, it was a couple of questions ago on our role in doing God's will. Because God is in control. God is running the show. But he calls us to come alongside him to make sure his will is done on earth as it is in heaven. So those are your questions to contemplate. If you didn't catch that or you didn't get a chance to write those down, again, you can watch the video again and get a chance to write those down and ask those questions. So that's it for this Lenten series. We'll be looking at normal guide sessions starting next Wednesday. If you have any thoughts or suggestions on topics, please pass those along to me. I'd love to have something to use based on what you're seeking to know or learn or grow in. So yeah, pass those along to me. I'd really, really appreciate that. So having said that, we have our next song and then our closing prayer. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God. Oh, I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God. You unravel me with a melody, and you surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, until all my fears are gone, and I'm no Let's bow our heads in prayer. God, you are a very loving, gracious God. We know that. We've experienced your love. We've experienced your grace in the past. You also call us to a higher standard than our culture, our world around us. You call us to a higher standard of not only living daily life, but also in living an ethical life that influences those around us, so that we can be participating in building up your kingdom, so that we can participate in having your will be done on earth as in heaven. Lord, remind us that our citizenship is first and foremost in your kingdom, that our citizenship here on earth is secondary. But if our living into your will has anything to do with anything, then we will make living here as a citizen on earth a significant part of our life, so that others may come to become citizens of your kingdom. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, and we'll see you next week.